Hotep community, welcome back to First Frequency of Oneness and Shock Metaphysics. I am your host, the Metaphysical Morpheus, and we are back this week with another amazing episode and lesson with our beloved elder of First Frequency of Oneness, Dr. Clyde Winters. Welcome back to the platform, Doc.
Yeah, how you doing?
I'm good. I'm excited about this topic, the origin of mankind.
We're going to talk about that today because many people don't really know too much about that. You know, as I said earlier, very few people have had a good history course, and very few people had a good history course, and they don't really know how man originated and how we expanded out of that. You know, and
Go ahead, Doc. But I was going to ask you, what are the theories for the origin of mankind?
Okay, well, like it's basically two theories about the origin of mankind. These two theories, one theory is the polygenetic theory of mankind, and the other one is the monogenetic theory. What they did is that using archaeological evidence, they began in a sense to try to determine where did man originate, how did man originate, and stuff like that. And what they found is that black people had originated in Africa. And the way they did this is that it goes back to when
I'm putting your PowerPoint in the screen right now. Did you want this up right now?
Oh yeah, you can put it up.
Okay, there we go. We got it up. Go ahead. And I'll make it full screen for the family so that way they can see it even better on their device, especially if they're on their phone. Go ahead, doctor.
Okay, so there's two theories. And the polygenetic theory says that that each individual racial group originated in their particular country. Maybe Europeans originated in Europe, Asians originated in Asia, and Africans originated in Africa. Then you have what's called the monogenetic theory. And the monogenetic theory is that each population is descendant from mankind, and that mankind originated in Africa. And as we discussed last week, a lot of this came from the study in 1996 of C4. And in the study of C4, what they found is that people, in a sense, began to recognize that black people had to have originated in Africa. Also, these people that originated were black people, or they had Eumelian. And the reason they believe that is because of the fact that in tropical regions, things are much darker. And so that's one of the ways, in a sense, that people believe that man originated in Africa.
So you say where did mankind originate? Obviously, it was in Africa. But you also talked about, I think if it wasn't last week, maybe it was a couple of weeks ago, that even Europeans didn't come from Europe. So walk us through that. Where did mankind originate? Obviously Africa, but go in a little deeper with us.
Well, the main thing is that that mankind originated in Africa. And from Africa, mankind began to migrate across the various continents. The Americas is kind of a fakey place. What I mean by that is that America is a place that when you study the archaeology of North America, you find that it's really tricky, you see. That's why right now you see these so-called weather changes, places that are being flooded, places that are on fire.
Yeah.
That's the way America's always been. So it's kind of hard to really, in a sense, talk about the prehistory of America. But you can talk about the prehistory of black people in Africa. In America, you can't talk too much about prehistory because of the fact that in the Americas, they had the Ice Age. And this Ice Age led to a lot of places being covered with ice. And because it was covered with ice, we don't have evidence of the people that maybe formerly lived there.
So is it possible that, I know, I forgot, I think it's in San Diego, it's the oldest fossil found about 160,000 years ago, which was an African. So we know we've been here longer than that. So is it possible that if they dig even deeper, they might find us, if you will, during the pre-ice age? Is that possible at some point in the future?
They could possibly do that. That particular artifact that you're talking about is 130 years old.
130,
But what it is that it's not really any human bones. It's really a bone of a mastodon that shows marks on it. You know, back in the day, people, in a sense, they didn't have knives, but they would have sharpened stones. And the bone that they found, which is 130,000 years old, it shows where they had scraped the meat off to eat it. So that's why they say that man was there. We don't know what type of man it was, but we can assume that. But we can assume it had to have been a black person. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that in it's a book I think called Hidden Archaeology. They say they found certain things, but it's very complicated.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So what do archaeologists use to identify human beings?
Well, what archaeologists use, let me try to share the screen.
Sure.
And
While you're doing that, I see Ron Spears is out there. Brother Ron, what's going on? You got your notepad. You ready? CC Sicily Campbell, love you, goddess. Haven't seen you in a while. Miss you. Greg West, my brother in Ohio. D. Davenport, Pamela Green, I see you. Brian Bino, Allegra, B-Man was first on. B-Man ain't playing. He ain't missing nothing. Hotep family and community. Okay, I'm putting this in the, there we go. Go ahead, Doc.
Okay, well, this is some of the stuff that they look at. These are real nice skulls. But most of the time what they find is they find these various bones. And these bones are usually fragmentary bones that are broken. For example, in the picture on the left, you can see where they have finger bones. Then we see, in a sense, in that same picture of Homo habilis, we find a partial skull. We can see maybe the teeth, maybe the eye socket, maybe where the nose was. But then that's not as refined as the skeleton that's on the right side. On the right side, we can see Homo erectus. And you can see how this particular skeleton looked. And what we do is that they look at these skeletons, they examine them, and they're able, in a sense, to try to determine how old various people was. If you look around the brows, around the eyes, that's where you look at these ridges right above the eye. These ridges, in a sense, that shows the antiquity of these people. And in fact, the older skeletons of hominids always depict people, in a sense, with these high brows. And these high brows, in a sense, relate to their antiquity.
Excellent. So by definition, our beloved, what is a hominid?
Well, a hominid is simply, what they consider to be a pre-human. Hominids are characterized by walking on two legs, and this form of locomotion is called, in a sense, bipedalism. Mm-hmm. And bipedalism simply meant that these particular individuals were, in a sense, walked on two legs. They usually, in a sense, when they discuss this, they talk about the fact that these particular hominids, they can be pre-man, or they can be, in a sense, what they call Homo sapiens. Okay, mm-hmm. Pre-men are usually called Homo because that means that they're in that hominid series, that they're man-like creatures. Mm. When they say Homo sapiens sapien, that has a different definition.
So what are Homo sapiens?
Well, Homo sapiens is just
in reference to in deference than a hominid.
Well, Homo is the name for man, but Homo sapiens sapien, that means, in a sense, that they're what's called anatomically modern humans. And anatomically modern humans mean is that they had the same features that we have. You know, they have faces like ours, or faces like contemporary people. And it's through these facial features that that we become known, in a sense, in terms of in terms of humanness.
Fantastic. So if you could explain the chronology of hominids moving up to Homo sapiens.
Okay, the first thing to understand is that when we talk about the rise of hominids, we're talking what's called the Stone Age. The Stone Age is divided into three broad periods. The Old Stone Age, or Paleolithic, which lasted from 2 million years ago to 10,000 years ago. The Middle Stone Age, which lasted from 10,000 BC to 6,000 BC. And then the New Stone Age, sometimes referred to as the Neolithic, which lasted from 6,000 to 300 BC. Okay, let me share the screen.
Okay. And we got some questions in the audience too. I want to pop up in there before we get
okay,
to the next.
Okay, after we go through this, you can. I'll try to answer those questions.
Oh, okay. All right. So let's see here. Angel. Let's put it on the screen. She says, the last ice age did not cover the southern regions of North America. I don't know if this is that true or not.
Well, it rarely covered the southern regions of North America. For example, when they talk about hominids or humans that lived, you know, up in North America, they basically tried to begin at 12,000 BC, but that's all bull. They found sites in North America to go back to 45,000, 59,000. Wow. So she's absolutely correct.
Excellent. Cicely Campbell, she says, can we talk about the age of Homo erectus versus the age of Homo sapien, which I think is what you're getting ready to do. So is that correct, or is that a different question than what you're already going to be presenting?
No, we're going to talk about Homo erectus, because Homo erectus is a very interesting hominid.
Okay. All right. Let me put the screen up here and keep the questions coming. I know Cece was Eve was erectus, I think. We'll get to that in a moment. Okay, this is the evolutionary path from ape to man. Go ahead, Doc.
Okay, well, scientists believe that there were two branches of hominids that are descended from Australopithecus afarensis, who lived 2.8 million years ago. One group was Australopithecus robustus. Okay, if you look at this particular picture, you can see these ape-like creatures. There's two ape-like creatures, Australopithecus robustus and Australopithecus africanus. These are supposed to be hominids, but they were man-like creatures. And as you can see, they had bipedalism. The interesting thing about these hominids is that they made tools. Most of the time, archaeologists characterize man or man-like creatures as tool makers, you see. Mm-hmm. And we see the path that led directly to man began with Homo habilis. And as you can see, Homo habilis, he's called the handyman. And the reason he's called the handyman, you know, is because of the fact that he lived 2 million years ago, and he began to make tools, as you can see in this particular illustration. The handyman or Homo erectus has a tool in his hand.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
After Homo erectus, we know in a sense there was a home. After Homo habilis, we had Homo erectus. Homo erectus stands for upright man. Upright man came after Homo habilis. He's about 500,000 years ago. This hominid made tools and was the first man to leave Africa and settle parts of India, China, and Southeast Asia. Most of the people who talk about the polygenetic origin of man, and as I said earlier, the polygenetic origin of man is the idea that each race developed in a different in on each continent. And what they use as an example is Homo erectus. And they believe that since Homo erectus is found in India, Homo erectus is found in China, Homo erectus is found in Southeast Asia, you know, they believe in a sense that that the various races could have originated from Homo erectus, which they believe was 1.6 million years ago. It's very important to remember that it's the white man, in a sense, he gives us all the dates for everything, because he's supposed to be able to date these periods. So the dates that I'm giving are those dates that that many anthropologists and archaeologists accept. The most important thing about Homo erectus is they believe that around 400,000 years ago, that Homo erectus discovered fire. And fire was a very important thing because fire allowed for two things to happen. Number one, it allowed for people to be able to cook. And number two, it allowed for people to be able to keep warm. Mm. And so this is a very important important invention because of the fact that in a sense, when people were able to cook, then women developed the most important element on earth. And what's the most important thing on earth that's able to sustain people? And what that is stew. The stew. Mm. Because see, women in a sense, what they did back in the day is that we had hunting and gathering. As you know, the men hunted and the women gathered. The women gathered berries. They gathered other plants. That's why they were the first pharmaceutical industry was women, because they found all these pharmaceuticals. But most importantly is that they took those grasses that they found and they put those grasses in a basket or a calabash, because they didn't in a sense maybe make bows, but they could make a calabash, and they would heat these calabashes at a slow heat, and they were able in a sense to put in the water, put in the vegetables, put in a little meat, and they made a stew. And these stews could sustain people for an extended period of time.
Mm. Excellent information. This is phenomenal. We are in a PhD class with Dr. Clyde Winter's family. Question from Kavan Anthony. He asked, are all, I don't know if this is related or not, but it's a good question. Are all people on the African continent Nubians? Or should we be changing our verbiage?
I think you can say whatever you want, but all people on the African continent are not Nubians. Nubians is just a name for the Nile Valley. And next week I'm going to be more specific in terms of the black variety. Mm. Black variety. In mm-hmm. other words, in a sense, when I talk about the races next week, I'm going to explain that there's not one type of black person. You see, there's been different. Black people have originated in Africa at different times in history, and they expanded from Africa to other parts of the world. As I said before, is that it's very important to understand that all people, you see, may have an African ancestry, but as each individual African moved from place to place, these Africans, in a sense, developed a different heritage, a different way of life, you see. And then Homo sapiens sapien, and that, if you notice, it's Homo sapiens sapiens, that means that this is modern man. Mm-hmm. And that Homo sapiens sapiens are anatomically modern humans. And they're called Homo sapiens sapiens because Homo sapiens means wise human.
Okay. So talk to us about what were the migration routes of the Homo sapiens?
Well, the Homo sapiens migrated all over the world. What he did in a sense is that We began in modern Tanzania and Ethiopia. And what happened is that these Homo sapiens, what they did is that they began to early colonize various parts of the world. What they believe is that we find that the earliest type of Homo sapien, they appeared around at Omo about 190,000 to 200,000 years ago. And then in Urdu, Ethiopia, we find skeletons that date back to 154 to 160,000 years ago. And so then many people believe that man may have originated in East Africa. But we find that in Southern Africa, we find in a sense that that there we find even earlier dates for what we call Homo sapiens sapiens. For example, in Broken Hill, it's dated, the site of Broken Hill in South Africa is dated to 110,000 years ago. The site at Classes River Cave is dated to between 65 to 105,000 years ago. And at Forested, South Africa, they found skeletons, just like I showed you those skulls, they found skeletons or partial skulls dating back to 190,000 to 330,000 years ago.
What?
So it's been Homo sapiens all over the place. From here, they migrated across the world. recently, they did a study, and they believe that that in modern day Botswana, Magadi, Okavango, they believe that this may have been, in a sense, one of the earliest homelands of man. And they believe, in a sense, that between 130,000 and 110,000 years ago, they began, in a sense, to migrate to different parts of the world. Right now, in a sense, when you look at a map of Africa today.
So who was the Homo sapien to leave Africa?
The first Homo sapiens to leave Africa would have been the Australians. Mm. Then after the Australians came the Khoisan. You see? But during the Stone Age, a period between 2 million and 500 BC, it's called the Stone Age. And these are Paleolithic men. These are two guys right here. These are what's called the Khoisan or the Sand People.
This is amazing.
But the first people to leave Africa were the Australians. And I think they left around 130,000, between 130,000 and 65,000 years ago. I wrote an article on this a few years ago for Ancient Origins. And but we'll maybe discuss that later. But if you notice, these are some people from Australia. If you notice, right across the bridge of their the bridge, right across their above their eyes, you can see where that bridge extends. And that's what I'm talking about, is that you find, in a sense, that the earliest types of man had these broad bridges. And that's one of the reasons why I believe that the Australians may have been the first anatomically modern humans to migrate out of Africa into other parts of the world, because they still maintain, in a sense, these broad bridges.
Yes.
These broad bridges, in a sense, I think shows that they were the... they were the first to leave. Also, some of them went by boat, some of them walked. They migrated into India, Southeast Asia, the Pacific and Indian Ocean Islands. You know, there's some evidence that the world didn't always look the way it looks today.
Mm-hmm.
Because it didn't look the way it looks today, then therefore, in a sense, you know, things are a little bit more complicated.
Sure, sure. Now, one of the most controversial topics that I have seen on the internet and with our scholarship, and I have not found to date a scholar to be able to answer definitively this question, and I'm talking about every scholar that I've had on the platform. Talk to us about, what was the Neanderthal man?
Okay, Neanderthal man... the Neanderthal man was just another brother. But see, what happened is that in Europe, they originated a different type of hominid. They say they're a different type of hominid, but that's a lie. Neanderthals, you know, and they say that Neanderthals are not considered to be anatomically modern humans. In 1829, in a sense, they found Neanderthal artifacts. And the Neanderthal people, they made tools, they buried their dead, they made houses, and they made things like that. The interesting thing about the Neanderthal people is that the Neanderthal people, what they did is that they were able to, in a sense, to create a very beautiful civilization. But the white man, you know, as usual, he doesn't have any history. And so he's paid special attention in terms of trying to create a false history.
Mm-hmm.
He tries to create a false history of the Neanderthal, because he tries to use the Neanderthal to explain how he came into being.
Mm.
It's all a lie. It's all a lie. Let's look at this. I'm going to share the screen, and we're going to look.
By the way, family, Dr. Winters has given me permission to take the PowerPoints and turn them into a PDF and put them up on our Patreon. So if you're a Patreon member, you'll already have access to it. If you're not a Patreon member, you need to get your butt over there, because we're giving the real deal, because some of this stuff can't be put into algorithms and they take stuff down and all of that. So we've got a little secret spot, if you will, where you can go and you can get this information. Let's put this up on the screen. Okay, go ahead. Oh, this is a different PowerPoint. Go ahead, Doc.
Okay, so the very important thing is that they try to tell you, they make all these pictures, and all these pictures of how they claim that Neanderthal man looked. Okay, what happened is this. In 1829, they discovered these bones. When they discovered these bones showed that the first Europeans, which they called Neanderthals, had wide noses and big lips. Mm. And so when they found these skeletons of wide-nosed people with big lips that were short, they said they were ugly. They said they were, but the reason they said they were ugly was why? In 1829, we was in the midst of the slave trade. They knew that the only people who had big lips, the only people who had big lips and wide noses were what? Were their slaves. And so the Europeans, they didn't want to admit that these people were Negroid, because remember, they tried to make up this lie that Europe was their homeland. But Europe wasn't their homeland. So when they found these Neanderthal skeletons with these broad features, they declared them ugly. They tried, in a sense, to say they didn't try to depict them, period, except for some dumpy people. But then let's look at it. But then as in the 1980s, 1990s, they began this whole new idea, as you can see in this picture, of trying to make them light skinned. Sometimes they even try to show them with families of all these light skinned people. Mm-hmm. That is a lie. That is a lie. There's no evidence that Neanderthal or any of the ancient people before 7,000 BC were light skinned, except in a sense, in relation to how they would have looked like we look. I mean, like us, we can have a dark child. We can have, in a sense, a light-skinned child. When I was growing up, you know, we had our light-skinned side and we had our dark-skinned
side.
That's right.
Okay,
together, baby. Daddy was light-skinned. Mama was dark-skinned. Together! But let's look. If you look at this picture, you can see this picture. This is how they believe Neanderthal really looked. In the picture down the bottom, we see Neanderthal. Then we see the West Australoid and the Tasmanians. And if you notice, the Neanderthal man, again, look above the eyes. He has those broad bridges, as I talked about earlier. Then when we look at the Australoid people, we again see the bridges. They're not as broad, but they're still broader than most people. Mm-hmm. Then we came down, in a sense, to looking at Tasmanians. And the Tasmanians, as you know, were killed completely. But later, by 44,000 BC, we see that they began to come out with the first Europeans. Here we have, in a sense, in the last picture on the right, we can see the first people who lived in Britain. You know, they always like to give them some stringy hair. I don't know what type of hair they had. I don't think they found any skeletons, but with hair on it dating back to that period. But here we have the first European from Britain, and on the right hand side we have a Romanian black person. Okay, in 2017, they began to see that they found what's called a Lebrana man. And the Lebrana man was, whoa, they found that these people at 71,000 years ago, they had blue eyes, but dark skin. They are the Lebrana man that they tried to reconstruct. They made the skull a little bit thinner. And when they tried to reconstruct it, they made it look as though he had European features. But this is how Lebrana man would have looked. See, a lot of black people think you had to go and buy some, some contacts to get blue eyes, but that's not true. There's many black people who have blue eyes, you know, or gray eyes. I know my father had gray eyes, you know. And you know, and some of the ladies said that I have pretty eyes too, but we're not golden. They said that when I was younger.
Come on, Doc.
When I got old, they said, "Nigga, what?"
Yeah. Oh my God! Now I got a couple of questions in the audience, so I want to, for clarification, let me
go ahead.
let me run up here. Hold on a second. I'm just going to remove this temporarily. You can keep it up, but let's see. All right. So CC said, as a lot of literature says, the first whites were around the time of Neanderthals. Is this accurate, or were they, or were the whites later?
They were. It's inaccurate. The whites don't show up until much later. Most of the whites, they weren't in Europe. They came from Central. They come from Central Asia, the Caucasus Mountains. Neanderthal man was black because, as I told you before, the earliest evidence, of blue eyes and dark skin go back to Lebrana man. So Neanderthal could not have been light skinned because here you can see right here that those people that were 7,000 years ago, they looked like this girl and this boy. See, and so this whole idea of blue eyes, but they try to tell you that that, you know, if you find people with fine features, you know, thin lips, those are white features. No, those are not white features. Black people were first. Wow. If black people were first, those are black features. That's why you may find some Somalis. You may find some Dravidians. Like Dravidians, they have straight hair, but I mean, some of them are coal black. Blacker than black. Even Kamala Harris, yeah, I'll be honest. You know, she's an AKA, and, you know, she's an AKA, but the thing is that some people have disputed her Negro-ness, but the Tamil people over in India, they accept the fact that they're black, you see? And the only difference is that they have straight hair, but they have Negroid features, and some of them even have much more kinkier hair. But we do know that 7,000 years ago, that these people, you know, that's when they first find colors.
Hold on, I got another question from Cece, good doctor. So she says, oh, wow, so we need to not call them Europeans, just Asians? They're all Asians?
They're Central Asians, yeah.
Wow. But Go ahead, Cece. You're at the top of the class, sister. You got the right questions. Come on now.
See, Europe was a black continent. It was a black continent until 1000 BC. A lot of Europeans, they call them the people of the sea, around 1400 BC. These white people began to expand into Africa, Asia, and other places.
Okay.
There were already some light-skinned people here. And these light-skinned people that was already here are what we call Assyrian Arabs. You know those people that you see in Syria?
Mm-hmm.
Or the Afghanistan, those Afghanistans coming over here, they're just white people, if you know. They just need to cut the beard off. They're white. Those people did exist. But what we consider modern Europeans, we don't see them coming on the scenes until after about 1400 BC, and they began to expand out of Central Asia into Europe, Africa, and the rest of the world and start taking over. Can everybody see this slide now?
Yes, we can.
Okay. What they tell you is that the two genes that produce light skin are SLC24A5 and SLC45A2. They said that this leads to depigmentation and therefore pale skin in Europeans. But the problem is that all black people carry SLC24A5 and SLC45A2.
The only
difference is that white people carry more of them. And because they carry more of them, that makes their skin a little bit pale. That makes their skin more paler. Then the Asians, a little less pale. But the fact is that don't let anybody tell you that we don't already carry those genes. That's why we can have light-skinned children and dark-skinned children.
Makes all the sense in the world.
And it also explains why if you mate with a white person or an Asian person, if you're a male, that child is probably gonna come out looking more Negroid or Africoid, you see? Because of the fact you already carry those genes, you see? And here we can see some people from the Solomon Islands. You can see they got some black people already had blonde hair, some black people already had blue eyes. If you see in this picture, this is from the Solomon Islands. If you look at the picture on the left, you can see a blonde guy. You can see a kid in a sense with straight hair. I mean that's just part of being black. But what they do is that they try to teach you that that black people can't really in a sense have any light skin.
We are the first people. Hold on, Doc. There's a question from Jerome Walker. He says, why do whites have a higher percentage of Neanderthal?
They have a higher percentage of the Neanderthal DNA. I'm going to answer that question after this slide.
Okay.
Some of the other things for light skin are HERC2 and OCA2. And these are associated with light skin, eyes, and hair in Europeans. But we find many of the people, the Khoisan or the Sand people in South Africa. In fact, most of the Sand people were the first people to the first anatomically modern humans to migrate into Europe from Africa. And as you can see, these Sand people, in a sense, they left us a lot of artifacts. And it was kind of a society that made a lot of heavy women. I mean, hey, most brothers, you can't find a brother now that don't like a big booty woman.
Oh! Hey, man, that's me. Come on with it. That's it.
I heard that.
Walk in the trunk. Let's do it.
That's right. Get on down, baby. But here's the thing. You see, they always tell you they can't hardly find any Neanderthal genes in Africans. The reason they can't find any Neanderthal genes hardly in Africans is that Neanderthal, the first Europeans, they were the same. They were still black. Wow. The Neanderthals were Negroes just like the Cro-Magnon people.
Wow.
They replaced them. See, but white Europeans had always believed that they were native to Europe. But see, once they found, in a sense, those Neanderthal skeletons, they had to make them look different. So they showed these pictures of these so-called Neanderthals with light skin. As I told you, I just discussed Lebronoman. And Lebronoman was a skeleton that archaeologists and geneticists discovered in 7000. And what they discovered in 7000 is that this is the earliest time that they believe people were able, in a sense, to go through this process. And so what happened, we find, in a sense, is that they're very upset about this, but they have to keep on maintaining this lie that Neanderthal was light-skinned so they can explain their origins. They have no history.
Woo!
They have no history in Europe.
Wow. See?
And as I'm going to show next week, yes, they say that man originated in Africa, but there was never any Asians in Africa.
Wow.
There were never any Europeans in Africa. It was only various African or black groups. And these black groups or African groups led, in a sense, to the rise of various people. But Neanderthal is very important. But Neanderthal is just one of the lies they tell us. But they have to, in a sense, tell us this lie. Because by telling us that Neanderthals were white, then that gives them a history. It gives them a purpose, you see?
Mm.
But how many white people have you ever found with big wide noses and big lips like they do the Neanderthal?
Unless they purchase them.
You stop it there. Stop it, Robert. Stop it.
Let's go back, Doc, for a moment.
Yeah.
To who were the first Homo sapiens, and was there one phenotype?
Okay, well, the earliest Homo sapiens in Europe were called Cro-Magnon man. And let me see, I already showed it, but we'll go back to that. The earliest Europeans were Cro-Magnon man. And Cro-Magnon man was the first European. And again, as I showed you a little while ago, I showed you the Cro-Magnon man who was in Britain, and also Cro-Magnon man was in Europe.
Mm-hmm.
But Cro-Magnon man This is a Cro-Magnon man.
Okay.
And again, as you can see, Cro-Magnon man, he was just another black guy. But see, you know, it's really a shame that these white people try to tell you that Neanderthals had different DNA than Cro-Magnon man or black people. But that's just another lie. You see? It's just another lie. Right here in a sense is that they've been knowing how Neanderthals look. But see, remember, most of your learning comes from your unconscious mind. And so what they do when they continually show you these pictures of a white or a pale-skinned Neanderthal, then in your mind you say, aha, that's how the Neanderthals look. Yeah, that's right. That's why. But, you know, what? How did they look like that? Then they were black. It's just all mixed up. But your mind is not going to fathom that because, see, you're going to want to believe that so that you can be a good third frequency person.
There you go. See? There you go.
If you believe that, if you consciously believe that, then therefore, in a sense, you will be a good guy. You know, if you believe in the theory of evolution, you know, even though they continually call evolution a theory, after a hundred years of research, beginning with Darwin, they still call evolution a theory. And the reason they call evolution a theory is because they've never found a missing link. And a missing link is that transition. Is that transition from, you know, one species to the next, you see?
Mm-hmm.
But then it's all a lie in the first place, because you can see in this picture, the, you know, Neanderthal don't look no different from the Cro-Magnon man on the right.
Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I mean, even if you read Geop's work, he talks about Cro-Magnon man as a European man. And you know, as if those were the first whites and Europeans. It's all bull. See,
wow.
That's one of the reasons why you have to do the research yourself. You have to do the research yourself, because when you do the research, you know, a lot of white people didn't mind telling the truth. A few of them told the truth, but although they may have told the truth, they're not going to put the truth in the popular literature. They do not want white people to know that Neanderthal man was black. They do not want white people to know that Cro-Magnon man, the first European, was black. Because if they know that Neanderthal was black, Cro-Magnon man is black, where do they fit?
Yep.
Man. See? Remember, second frequency people, they gain control by claiming that they are superior. And they make sure that if those black people who want to get the biscuits and little cheese toast, they're going to bring them into the plan as third frequency people. And the more they want to, in a sense, spread this lie of ancient history, the more it allows the white man to be superior. See, he doesn't want to admit to you that Europe was not his homeland. He doesn't want to admit to you that he came from where he came from. Where did he say he came from? He said he came from the Caucasus Mountains. The Egyptians said they came from where? The mountains of the moon. You see?
Wow.
But the Caucasus Mountains, they're not in Western Europe.
Oh.
See? But they couldn't claim that they were related to the Mediterranean people, the Greeks or the Romans. So then, in a sense, they tried to manufacture history. Remember, in a sense, they can't compete with you. If they let you become a professor and you dare to do research and you start telling the truth, you are a danger to them. They need people like Gates at Harvard University. You see, to keep telling you that you're a slave, that your whole existence has been a slave, because they don't want you to know that if you become first frequency, you can count on almost a million. They just say maybe they found skeletons that are 200,000, 300,000 years old. Some people say 500,000 years old, but no matter how old they were, if you're first frequency, you're able to go back and recover that knowledge. Recover the knowledge.
Incredible. Question here from Allegra Henderson. She asks, what percentage of our DNA is the phenotype? Human Genome Project says that humans are 99.1% the same, and our differences are only skin deep. Is this true?
Ever since the OJ trial, and they were able to use the OJ genetic evidence during the OJ trial to show that OJ did not commit the murder because he had different blood type, then people think that you can use genetics to identify races. You can't use genetics to identify races. The reason you can't use genetics to identify races is that all the genetic groups are carried by Africans or Black people. Since all the genetic groups are carried by us, then therefore, in a sense, the only way that you can tell how an ancient person looked is not through their genetics. You see? You have to look at the bones. That's why they talk about fragmentary bones. But the white man tell you, forget about the bones. Don't worry about the bones. Don't look at those bones.
I told you,
white people are one.
That's right. Second.
Asian people are D4 and UL and E, nigga. Don't you start bringing up no other haplogroups. But then when you do your own research, you find out that that's all a lie. We carry every haplogroup. We carry all the genes. You see? But they have to, in a sense, make it up. See, I might do a thing on genes, but I'll just do a quick thing. See, what happened is that geneticists always go back to 1492.
Mm-hmm.
The white man has created in his mind a lie. He created in his mind the idea that Black and white and other people did not come into contact until the slave trade.
Mm.
So they try to teach in a sense that since Black since Black people and white people, Mongoloids didn't come in contact until 1492, then whatever genes people carry today, then those genes describe who they were 500, 1,000, 5,000 years ago. That is bullshit. You see? Because Black people carry every gene. So they said that black people are carry the female line is L.
Mm-hmm.
The male line is E. White people, they carry in a sense a different branch. They carry in a sense M1. And they carry, and the male line is R. The Asians carry D4 as a female line and another one. That's all bullshit.
Wow.
Every one of those. When they call the Asians D4, D4 is nothing but M1. And M1 is also carried by people in Africa. R is carried by Africans. They found, and we know Africans have carried a long time, because when they excavated some of those slave graves in the Caribbean, some of those skeletons of slaves brought over here in the 1600s carried the R haplogroup.
Mm.
And so they thought they had a big idea. And the big idea is that, hey, wow, this is what the white man was thinking. Wow, damn. The Greeks said that Black people were the greatest people on earth. The most wonderful Ethiopians were the Kushites.
Mm-hmm.
Damn!
Mm-hmm.
Then our archaeologists who've done craniometrics, every ancient skeleton they find is of a Negro or an African.
Damn. Yeah, right? It's gotta hurt.
Why did we let them niggas go to school in America and be able to read the damn books?
What was that? Dave Chappelle, if you would have never gave those niggas money. We should have never let you go to school, Dr. Winters.
They should
get your PhD. Doggone it. Why did they let you do that?
Well, how they did, because they said they wasn't going to let me go no further. They thought I was going to just stick with high school. Now in university, I set out with a purpose. I read this book called The Man Who Cried I Am. And back in the 60s, they had what was called this plan to kill off all niggas, you know. Mm. Me and my wife, we were supposed to blow up the police station on 51st and Princeton, but they didn't give us any dynamite. But okay. I'm a teenager, so I'm dumb. I don't know what the hell. We're gonna blow it up, baby. Yeah. We're gonna blow it up when they bring the trains to take us to the concentration camps. But anyway, that was called the Alfred plan. And it was in a book called The Man Who Cried I Am. But also in the book that cried The Man I Am, when I read it, it said that why do black people in China, in West Africa, have the same names as people in China? Why do they wear the same hats? Why do black people in here do this? Oh, I wish I could get into those archives in Yemen. Then I find out the truth. So that sent me on a quest. Back in the day, I grew up on 47 and Prairie. I mean 47 and Evans. And at that time,
I came from 62nd and Evans.
Okay.
That 6224 South Evans Avenue, Woodlawn. That's where I was. That's my birthplace.
Well, I couldn't walk over there. They'd shoot me. But anyway,
that's true. No doubt. Yeah, I wouldn't have shot you.
Oh, well, you was a neutron like me. But anyway, so then that sent me on a quest. When I went to university, I had already talked to the brothers that they had a Morris Science thing around the corner. They told me a little Arabic. When I went to high school, I learned French. So when I went to university, I used to get a D in French. But I took French for 4 years, so I could speak French better than anybody at the university studying for their master's degree at Illinois. So when I got to Illinois, when I got to Urbana, I used to spend a lot of time in stacks, and I started collecting various tapes. Because you know we had a good anthropology library, so I started development tapes. So I learned about 10 languages. Now they all mixed up in my head. I learned the reading knowledge of 10 languages. Wow. And when I learned this reading knowledge, what I did is I used that to be able to go to the primary sources.
Yes.
So that's why the only people argue with me on the internet are these Euro nuts. You don't see no professors trying to argue with me because if I get a chance to reply, I'm gonna make you look like a dummy. So they're not gonna argue with me. So they'll get some layman, some Euro nut, and they'll say what Dr. Winters don't know. See? But the whole point is this, is that they still publish my articles in genetic journals.
Mm-hmm. 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 Mm-hmm.
I didn't get my degree from Harvard. I went to the big eye though.
That shows you know what you're talking about, and it can't be refuted. There's another question here by Molly Brown I want to ask. She says, Dr. Winters, the Cheddar Man found all of Europe, in the mess period, was black as well with blue eyes. Please discuss the Cheddar Man.
Well, the Cheddar Man, he was just one of the lot of people. He's still related to the Grimaldis and other people. The Grimaldis, the Cheddar Man, the Arignacians, all these were black people. But we find, in a sense, they came in at different times and they were different groups. For example, many people don't understand that most of the cultures that ended up in Europe originally were in South Africa.
Mm-hmm.
And these cultures moved up from South Africa all the way up to Europe. One of the reasons for this is that South Africans have two giant lakes. And that was the Mega Chad and there was another lake below Medichad, and they connected. Excuse me. These lakes were as large as the United States. Can you imagine that?
So no, you, I cannot. Wow.
So one day I'll show a map of it. So when you look at these lakes, you can see how people could ride all, they could get on a boat, and they could ride from, they could ride all the way from Southern Africa, you know, Botswana land, all the way up to Middle Africa, almost up to the coast, North African coast. Wow. And so then that's why Black people had all this expertise in navigating, and they had all this expertise in boat building. That's one of the reasons why Black people started sailing early, because Black people probably started sailing early because they would go fishing and stuff like that.
Yes.
So they made various.
Now you sent me, and I'm gonna put it in the chat. We were talking earlier about peer review. So there was a piece that I'm putting in the chat for the family at script.org. Can you brief us on? This is a peer reviewed on where were the first Europeans pale or dark skinned?
Okay, well that particular article is a very important article because back in the day a lot of people was trying to argue that that Neanderthal was white. And so what I did is that I show in this article that Neanderthal and some of the other ancient people could not have been white because there was no white people on the planet. According to archaeology, I can only go off the evidence. If I talk about something that's out of sight of my neck, then I'm going to be in trouble. So I stick to archaeology. And so what happened is that because of the fact that we don't have any evidence of these early so-called whites existing, then therefore we had to look at the archaeological evidence. And the archaeological evidence, even though it's fragmentary, they can still tell. For example, they can look at around your nose. When they look at a skull around the nose, it can tell you if that person was an African, an Asian, or a European. That's one of the reasons why they have these physical anthropologists. Sometimes they'll find a skeleton of someone who died years ago, and then they'll kind of reconstruct their faces. That's how they can give them the various elements. In terms of females, they find in a sense that you can look at the pelvic bone area of different females, and they can also show in a sense the ethnic heritage of that person. For example, white women, they have a pelvis bones that don't have to expand that far because we have slender heads. Asians have the largest heads, babies when they're born, so therefore Asian women have a larger pelvis area, you see. And so then what they do is that archaeologists look at the facial characteristics and they look at the pelvic bones to try to determine the racial identity of people.
Wow.
DNA can't tell you anything about no racism. And so in this article, I talk about, you know, how we carry all the genes. I talked about it earlier, the SE, whatever. We carry all those genes. We also carry the herp genes. We carry all those genes. Mm. And therefore, in a sense, we could have made, you know, light-skinned people anytime we wanted. But next week, I'm going to talk about how I believe the races came about. I don't believe in evolution. I believe that God created man. And I'm going to explain how the black gene or melanin and our DNA led to the that's right, our DNA, the same stuff that they put in the jab.
Yep, the same stuff.
Same stuff they put in the jab, which is you know, why it could play a role with melanin in terms of changing various hominids or Homo sapiens into various different racial categories. Because again, like wow. I said.
Hold on before you give us the tea and the cliffhanger for next week's show. You have a blog,
yeah,
that I want to post here in the chat for the family.
Okay,
and talk to them about this blog, Dr. Winters.
Okay, this blog. What it is that I've been doing a social studies blog because I taught high school and I was teaching university, But a lot of times, in a sense, people are looking for information on how to teach Common Core State Standards social studies. Mm-hmm. So I've been looking on Facebook, and I noticed a lot of foundational Black American parents want to homeschool their kids, or they want to give their kids some supplemental information. Let me share the screen.
Okay, go for it.
So,
and we got some questions in the audience too, and I have a final question as well.
We'll do this real quick.
Sure. Take your time.
Okay, so on my blog,
ain't nobody going nowhere. That's for sure.
Ain't nobody. On my blog, going nowhere. What I did is that I put a world history curriculum, social science curriculum map, and in this social science curriculum map, it tells you the books you can use. It tells you how you can organize each unit and what you can teach during those units so that you could help your child. If you want to try to teach your kids some world history, you can use it to even give you a program to study world history. I talk about, in a sense, the introduction to geography, everything out of Africa. I talk about how everybody came out of Africa, but it's very important. Now, I don't want people to get a fit, because a lot of people over here to say, I'm not African. You are African, but your heritage may be different. If you want to say you're more, fine. If you want to say you're only a Black Native American, fine. But your African is your ancestry. Your heritage is what those individual Africans came here and they developed and culture. I talk about, everything out of Africa, and I talk about the development of the Eastern Mediterranean. I give you different books, different pages that you can read up on, that you can have your kids read, and ask them some questions. When I was teaching, I always tried to tell my parents that if you do want the kids to know stuff, what you have to do is that you have to ask them the you have to ask them the right questions. Mm. When you ask them the right questions, what you find is, now I got to get out of this thing. So when
you're out of it on our end, we see you. Yeah.
Okay.
But you probably can't see us.
No, but I didn't see you. I can see you now.
Okay. But, how you doing? Okay.
What I found in a sense is that it's just something that for those parents who are interested in trying to find some information on how they can teach their kids world history about Black people, this will be a good guide. Also, on this particular blog, I also list various lesson plans, all type of good stuff that can help parents have ideas to really try to teach their kids, because a lot of Black people are complaining about the fact that they're tired of going to these schools, sending their kids to schools, and their kids are coming back ignorant. Their kids are coming out of these programs with no knowledge of self and no confidence. Mm-hmm. And they're coming out they're coming out third frequency. Mm-hmm. And then sadly, some of them are being picked up by the gangs and never coming fourth frequency.
That's correct. See?
And that's because of the fact that they lack an identity. You have to give your kids an identity.
Go ahead, please.
First, when I talked to Reverend, Reverend Matthews, I was just going to discuss my various books. What I decided is that we're going to begin at the beginning, move on up, and then really go into this history. And the thing is that you can go and check out stuff. You can ask me questions. But the main thing you have to understand is that there's some good stuff out there, but generally white people lie.
My goodness. I'm so blessed. I'm so blessed and honored to be able to bring this to the community and level the playing field, correct the history conflated and convoluted. Two questions. GoTravelBroad.com says, Dr. Winters, please expand on the significance of ancestors buried with gold tongues found Magna Temple. Do you know about that?
I don't know anything about it, but you can imagine that it must have some greedy people that wanted gold. You know, but see, gold, gold, uh, gold wasn't really considered valuable to black people. That's why they gave gold away. When the Portuguese came, they gave them gold. They didn't care about gold. Black people, in a sense, they didn't see gold as that important. They saw copper. They saw copper as the most valuable material because copper was pliable. You can make it into tools. And so then they, most black people saw copper is more valuable than gold.
Wow.
Gold, you know, gold is something that a lot of Europeans have loved the most. Mm-hmm. Black people saw it as pretty, but they weren't really, dominated by it. White man is fascinated by it.
All right, so your A student, Cece is back. She says, yes, the mRNA in the jab, that needs to be a show, please, Philippe. So, Doc,
I'm not going there.
You're not going there?
I'm not going.
Well, you can't really, because that's an algorithm, so I can't go into that. Right. Now, I am going to do something specific on Patreon because it's so much information. I was just with Dr. Ferguson, Elaine Ferguson, yesterday. She's going to be coming on again. There's so much information on this
Boyce Watkins, he interviewed a lady a few weeks ago, and she who was an immunologist, and she really broke down the problem with the vacations and stuff.
But again,
when I talk about our DNA, I'm going to talk about how it probably played a role in the rise of race. See, our DNA is very interesting. When you look at regular DNA is a spiral, but our DNA is straight. And what happens is that our DNA can wrap around other materials, and that's one of the reasons why it's very pliable. Mm. But the only thing about our DNA is that it can make changes in your genetic code. It can be epigenetic changes on a physical basis. But again, remember those changes in a sense can be long term. But it won't be exactly. Let's say you can't make a serum. I'll put it like that. Mm-hmm. You can't make a serum with our DNA. You see. Whenever you had to look at black people taught white people how to make vaccinations.
Mm-hmm.
When they make it, you got to have a little bit of the virus in the particular vax, and our DNA don't have any of it in it.
Mm-hmm.
You see, it can change structures. It can make new structures. But it only makes new structures. It doesn't give you any antibodies.
There it is. So let the family know. I'm going to be because Patreon doesn't have social media algorithms, so yeah. It can't be targeted. It can't be taken down. It can't be labeled as false. So I have collected the last 4 months or so that I've been working with Dr. Ferguson and some other people. All of this data, and I have to admit this publicly. My queen and I are alive today because of Dr. Ferguson's information. And people have called me and asked me for help of what to do about this situation. And it's so convoluted. I just decided. After talking with Dr. Ferguson yesterday, that I'm going to go on Patreon. We're going to do a private live stream, and I'll probably after I do it, I'll take it down because it'll be unlisted on YouTube. But there's some things the family need to know of what to do to take care of themselves. There are rituals. There are things that I do on a daily basis. There's vitamin therapies and certain things I do on a daily basis to completely build my immune system and make me immune to all of this crap. So, but I can't talk about it. I can't show it. I can't demonstrate it. So I'm going to do that. Dr. Winters, if I could, I have one last question that I think is very important as we close this out. Why is the identity of Black Homo sapiens, sapiens sapiens, important in our understanding of who we are?
Okay, the reason that you want to know about the Black Homo sapiens sapiens is that, number one, you want to understand why we are first frequency. Mm. And when you understand in the sense that we're the amalgamation of various Black populations that appeared at different times throughout the history of the Earth, and that these populations had different experiences, and from these experiences, it left us with a framework in which we can use to become more creative, which we can use in a sense to be able to make ensure that civilization will always be advanced. I think, as I said earlier, they put many so-called mongoloid people on reservations. Those reservations ain't popping. And, and most of the casinos are controlled by white Indians. Who took over, you know, okay, back in Oklahoma, whenever in a sense you had a Norwell, even the Black people, if a Norwell was found on your land, then they had a white person to shepherd you. And usually they kind of died. and then the shepherd was still there. Mm-hmm. Or the shepherd would marry him, and then the mongoloid Indian would die, but the shepherd would live, and then he would marry another European, and then after a while, that's why if you look at the chiefs of the Indians in Oklahoma, mostly all of them are white, or Caucasian. That's because of the fact, in the sense that you know, the FBI even investigated, but they didn't care. Mm-hmm. They didn't care that they took those people land by marrying them in oil. And so then that's one of the reasons why, in a sense, that you don't find a lot of mongoloid Indians really controlling big casinos.
You know? I lied to you when I said that was the last question, Doc, because you just said something that created another question. And somebody said something in an audience that triggered the question that I'm about to ask you. I think it was Bantu Mandinka that said there's nothing more to theorize. Africa is the mother and father's period. What happens, and it actually happened, I had a second frequency person on my platform years ago, and they referred to themselves as African because we all come from Africa. You know that second frequency is going to say, well, I'm African. Even in South Africa, the second frequency, they're claiming they're Africans. What is, in your opinion, what is the best counter to that? Because technically they are correct, but there's a distinct difference between first frequency and second.
Well, the thing is, that's if you're going to use that term African-American. That's why we've been moving away from African-American to foundational Black American. We're not going to talk about those people who live in Africa or those people who live in the Caribbean. We're talking about there's a difference here between first and second frequency people. And that difference is that first frequency people are foundational Black Americans, the people who created this civilization over here, the people who built this country. So then therefore, that's why people had to move away. If you look through most of my writings, most of the time I try to say Afro-American over the years. I sometimes wrote African-American, but very rarely. Because if you came from South Africa or Namibia and you were white, you were born in Africa, so you could legitimately say you were an African-American. Mm-hmm. But you can't say you're a foundational Black American unless your ancestors go back to the ones who built this country, who was over here before the Constitution.
Wow, there it is.
Here before the Constitution. So therefore, in a sense, you ask them where they came from. And so, you know, Anderson always says is that this is our country. We're a unique people. Mm-hmm. We're a unique people. And that's one of the reasons why I'm doing this history program. I'm doing this history program to show the unique history of Black people wherever we are. You see, therefore, in a sense, some of these dumb people, I'm not going to say dumb, but they'll say, don't call me Black. A black is a color. When you study African languages, Black can be a noun, an adjective, and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. In the white man's land, you know, Black is an adjective. See, That's not the way it is in all languages. But see, most of us don't know more than one language. When I went to school, they had what's called area studies. And so then therefore I was studying African history. So to really, even for my undergrad period, you know, you had a lot of the documents we read were in Arabic or in French.
Mm.
And so then, so you couldn't really do any research in this unless you could read French or Arabic. But now people come go to school, and unless you're at the Oriel Institute or Harvard or some of the really good studies program, you might graduate with a PhD. And I mean, back in the day at Illinois, to get a PhD, you had to at least know German or French.
Mm.
You get a PhD and only know English. And see, that's how the white man used to hide stuff from us. He would hide stuff from us because English, they might translate some stuff in English, but a lot of the good stuff they would leave in French. Like many of the so-called Arab writers who wrote about Africa, like Ibn Battuta and all that type of stuff, until fairly recently, all those books were in French. And so if you didn't read French, you couldn't get to the original sources, then they can tell you anything.
That's true.
And so then that's one of the reasons why you need these languages. But sadly, many of us don't really study a good language program. Even if you study Spanish, you would know that they had why did they have an Inquisition in the Americas?
Mm.
Because the Wolofs had spread Islam all throughout Mexico. So the Wolof and Mandi people had all these Indians going around saying, "Peace be to Allah."
In other words,
they're in the service of God. But they had to stop that stuff. That's why they rarely brought Wolof and Mandi over here. Down in Brazil, they brought a lot of Yoruba. But see, some Yoruba were nativists, and a lot of other Yorubas, in a sense, were Muslims, like the Naga. And we, like a lot of the Nago Yoruba, they introduced Islam, and a lot of them, in a sense, went back to Ouida over Nigeria after the end of slavery. And so then, but again, history is deep, but you have to learn those foreign languages.
Mm-hmm.
See, you had to learn those foreign languages to be able to study it. You know, now it's a lot of good stuff translated in English, but not everything. That's why they got all these people looking for the Anunnaki. Where you at, Anunnaki? That didn't exist.
Wow. Excellent discourse.
You know, and so then, but again, you know, it's...
Talk to us about your special report, Doc, because that special report I just put in the chat for the family. If you're also on, for those who are going to be seeing the archives of this, not the live, it's in the description. But it's on the topic of today. What can people expect from that special report?
Okay, what you can expect from that is that in special report, we go into detail about, you know, the origin of mankind. We talk about those little issues that relate to the spread and origin. We talk about the first man. We talk about the rise of man from Australopithecus all the way up to Homo habilis.
Mm-hmm,
we talk
mm-hmm.
about it in the sense their culture, some of their expressions. We talk about the various people that formed the nation. We do a little bit on the Neanderthal. I didn't really put it in the Neanderthal about the in the paper about the race, but that's one of the reasons why Reverend Matthews was able to post that article mm-hmm. about the pale versus white, pale versus were the first people pale or dark skinned. So that's an article you can read, and it's very important that I just like today. If you have some questions, put them in, and we'll try to answer them during the program. And if some of you want, and you can ask Reverend Matthews that maybe we might even have one show where we're just asking questions.
Oh,
but you would have to send the questions to Reverend Matthews ahead of
first,
time.
Before we go, yes. Yeah.
Well, because
yeah. You hear SEC, you got some questions for me? Send them on. I know you got
because we may even try to have, you know, we want the questions ahead of time because I can't talk about everything until I go back. I've written over 24 books and over about 500 articles over the years. So I wrote a lot of stuff, so I had to go back.
You got to refresh on your stuff. Isn't that, my God, what an archive, what a library you are, my brother. What a library.
Thank you very much, but I mean, I wanted to fulfill that goal. I wanted to find out what the man who cried I am, what he wrote in that book. Mm. You know, I wanted to find out those secrets. Because see, when I was in fifth grade, I saw this book. You know, this book, it had all these explorers. I said, damn, they had discovered everything. Damn. You know, and so then, but then I had so I always wanted to be an explorer. But then after I got older, I said, hey, you can still explore. You know where Hales High School is?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, when I was little, at Hales High School, I found me a sword, and I found some pottery. So I had my sword, and I was going to la-di-dee, because, you know, walking back, la-di-dee, and some big boys came and whooped my ass. Beat me up and took my sword. Oh, damn.
Oh.
But I said, you know, it was a Civil War sword and stuff. So, you know, but then I said, you know what? I can discover stuff by being the first person to do the research. That's one of the reasons why I deciphered a lot of languages, because I wanted to be the first. And by me being the first, and I could be that explorer that I always wanted to be since I was in fifth grade, you see? And so then the whole point is that you had to become first frequency, and you had to understand that you don't always have to be accepted by the European.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You don't even have to always be going through him. But that's why today I feel so sad sometimes. We got all these black professors, anthropologists, and archaeologists. We got archaeologists. Instead of them going trying to dig up ancient black villages in America, they dealing some damn slave cemetery. What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you?
Right.
You're so third frequency, it's out of it. And they're proud.
Bantu just said, he said, that's why Philippe and Dr. Winters call them second, third, and fourth frequencies. So yeah. This is what we do. This is what we do. And the beauty is, Dr. Winters, is developing the ability to be able to seek out the highest level of scholarship. And you know, over the last 7-10 years in the quote unquote woke community or the African community, there's not one scholar I haven't hit, and multiple times. And so what happens is, over time, you find a pattern, right? I'm a cause and effect guy, metaphysics. So what's the first cause? The cause is, the pattern is in the scholarship, everybody, all of the other scholars refer back somehow to your work. And it's very interesting how some of the offline conversations I've had with other scholars, and you kind of, you alluded to that when we had our private meeting with Billy Bird. By the way, family, if it's okay for Dr. Winters giving the permission, Dr. Winters is going to be, or is, our official elder for First Frequency of Oneness. So we've installed him as, and he don't have to do nothing else but what he's doing, and that is teach the community, share his research, and allow us to get on a same frequency of knowledge and wisdom, so that we don't go back and forth in the chat talking about this, that, and the third, and all of the banter and all of the genuflection, all of that crap. We need to be on the same page. So I had to find a historian of historians. I had to find what Obadashaka, in his work on the Dogon, would refer to as a Sodai. So Dr. Winters is Sodai. He is the guy that all other doctors, scholars, and professors quote. So he's at the top of the food chain in terms of knowledge and research. And then everybody else comes, you know, in play in that as well. So I'm just very honored to be in this position with this ministry, with these four frequencies that we found. Dr. Winters, in a very real way, you found me because I didn't know you knew of my framework, of my four frequencies framework. And when you put it into context in the work that you're doing, I have been doing, it was the biggest day of the ministry and everybody involved. So we're doing something here that's never been done before.
Well, so you had to understand is that I taught at Governor State University, and I taught at St. Xavier University. I taught research methods, and I taught educational psychology, attribution theory, all that good stuff. I mean, hell, they didn't want me teaching this, but the point is that I practice my field. But the most important thing to understand is that even though I was just a lecturer, I still published articles. You know, if you look at some of the books on leadership, I'm mentioning in two of the most popular books of the early 2000s. They mentioned Dr. Winters helped me do this and Dr. Winters helped me do that, because I tried to do my field. But the majority of Black people, they get to a university and all they want to do is just teach. You do research too, but they stay in their place. They stay third frequency. See, a good third frequency person, they're going to wait till a white man tells them what to do. They're going to stay, and they're going to stay in that limit. You see, I never wanted to limit myself. All praise belong to God. You see, my father taught me to be a man.
Wow.
You see, my father, he taught me he didn't want to see a bug broke, a bug broke brother. My grandson is always laughing when I say bug broke, that he didn't want to see a bug broke brother. You see, I have nothing against anybody, no matter their gender, whatever they want to be, that's what they can want to be. But my father said, be a man. And he said, a man, excuse me, Reverend, a man don't get fucked. Excuse me.
I love it.
You see? That's what my father told me.
We come from the same block.
That's what my father told me.
Wow.
That's what my father told me. A man stands on his two feet, and a man will try to fight to hold it. But I ain't shit without a woman. And I miss my goddess so much. She died last year, and I miss my goddess. I miss my goddess because I could count on her to tell me not to do stupid stuff. So now if I do something stupid and silly, it's all because of her.
No holds barred. How long were you together, beloved?
We were married for 50 years, but we were together for 52.
My God.
And so then my wife, she shared a womb. She gave me 6 wonderful kids. And they're knuckleheads, but I love them. They love me. She taught me to love, man. She taught me to love. I tried to hug. I had 5 boys. I had 5 boys and 1 girl. I kissed them all. I hugged them all.
Yeah.
I whooped some butt too. And my number one son, you know, he always tried to tell him I'm sorry, but you was the number one boy, and your brothers was looking at you. If I let you got away with stuff, it was gonna be a mess. But they turned out okay. None of them in jail right now, thank God. Cross my fingers. Absolutely. But the whole point is that my wife, she shared that with me. She taught me. She told me she said when they get 14, you got to be their friend. You can't keep whooping butt all the time. Mm-hmm. And I'm happy. I mean, now now at least we look at football games. They call me every now and then. I call them. So you got to try to love your kids.
Mm-hmm.
You got to see, that's a family. See, the most important thing is that I got married when I was 19, and I wish I could have married my wife when I was 12. Mm. Oops, that's crazy.
The point is that
when you got the mother goddess, I'm going to tell you guys out there, you know, you think getting a lot of pussy, and I'm a man. I liked it. I liked it.
But you think? Absolutely. Right. We all have a history.
But the point is that your woman can give you more than that. Your woman can open up a world for you. If your woman wants you to have something, you're going to get it.
Fact.
You hear me?
Real talk.
But if you're having 5 or 6 babies and you got 6 or 7 women out there thinking negative about you, it's going to be very hard for you to be doing positive stuff. You see?
Right.
See?
Right.
Absolutely. And then people say they outgrow somebody. you don't outgrow anybody. What you do is you stop talking to that person. Mm. You know, I'll never give them my wife said, I want to find myself. What the hell is this? After about 6 years, your woman started telling me they want to find themselves. It's scary. But the point is this, is that you had to understand that that's part of them being who they are. But see, if you can get through those, if you can get through that and learn to love your woman, learn to love your woman.
Yes.
Love her.
You see why he's the head. You see why he's the elder of the ministry, right? You can see this, what we're doing here. This is not, we ain't playing with nobody.
Yeah.
Now, Dr. Winters, I know you're going to be talking about the Mother Goddess in a couple of episodes, which I'm really excited to have that conversation with you. Also, family, Dr. Winters, if you notice, every lesson that he has is coming with a special report. So what's happening with this series is an actual intellectual property library that is specific to each class or to each show. Never been done ever that I know of in this particular genre. So this is a very special moment, a very special time. I want you to like, love, and share. I want you to tell everybody who you know, and particularly the people you don't necessarily like that you always argue with. If you really, truly want to shut the room down, shut down the conversation, or what my good friend used to tell me, if you want to give somebody a bottle of shut the fuck up, this is the show. This is the series that you need to share with those people so that all of this debating back and forth is a waste of time. It is a waste of your first frequency time. You need to know the truth. You need to know the facts. You need to know the science. You need to know the sources of those facts and science. And once you have that foundation, nobody can come in and tell you differently. That is first frequency.
And so, and also, I got about what? I got about 20 sites out there with hundreds of articles. If you put in Clyde Winters or Clyde Ahmed Winters, you're going to find I have so many websites.
Yep.
I've also got videos on YouTube. Mm-hmm. I've got at least almost 100 and something articles posted on academia.edu.
Yes, yes.
I have 24 books, and buy my books, and my books will help you to get a further understanding of some of the things we're talking about.
But well, you know, it's really good, Dr. Winters, what you're saying, because a lot of people have come to me over the years, and they always ask the question, I'm sure it happened to you. Hey, I'm new to this. What should I first read, or who should I first read? So now I can honestly say, all right, if you really want to know about first frequency, who you are, at the foundational level, start with Dr. Winters' library and then work your way out.
And the most important thing is that the reason I'm doing the PDF, I'm doing it for two reasons. Number one, I'm writing the PDF because I found over the years, because I've written a whole lot on Tamil history over in South India. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of the Dravidian people, they can speak English, but they can't understand it so well. So I found a lot of times when I wrote things out, they can read my papers and it can help you to get a clear understanding. Sometimes you can pick up stuff just from looking at a video over and over again.
Sure.
That's good. But it's also good to look at the reading. Also, it's to help the ministry because, Reverend Matthews doesn't really ask for donations and stuff like that.
Right.
And so then therefore, in a sense, when you buy the PDF, you're going to get knowledge. You're going to get a greater understanding of what we were talking about. But at the same time, you're helping the ministry. And the most important thing is this, is that
we do a Maathi and 50-50 split. So you get 50, the ministry gets 50, and everybody, and the community gets the knowledge. And that's the way to do it.
And it's about sharing power. But again, like I said, is that I just hate so much that we've been taught to be gas men. I'm not going to tell a lie. My father wanted me to be a whore. And but I met my wife and she was just too beautiful and had such pretty legs. Anyway, my God.
I love it.
But I would have made him happy if I'd have been a whore. Yeah. But I mean, hey, he was just a product of his time, you know?
Yeah, well, hurt people, traumatize people. Nothing's That's wrong right. with him. A lot happened to him. He went That's through right. Jim Crow for crying out loud.
That's right. But see, I'm gonna tell you this is that I've I went to university. I talked to white women. I talked to women, white women today. But it's nothing like a sister that's down.
Yes.
It's nothing like a sister that's down. You know, if she's down for you, she will be there. You know, I always felt like Conan the Barbarian because I knew that if I had to throw down in a fight, my wife, if she was there, she's going to throw down too.
She was going to say,
I'm serious.
Throw the first punch.
Well, she ain't going to throw the first punch. She always was ladylike. She wanted me to lead.
Okay.
But she wouldn't show what a fool I was out in public. She always made me look good.
Absolutely.
But I'm telling you guys out there is that love, find a woman that you can love. Try to have patience because, see, most black women never experience love.
Yeah.
Because they never experienced love, they don't know how. They don't know how to be loved.
Yeah.
But you had to take that woman and nurture her. You had to take that woman and have patience with her and let her know that you care because, see, she's been taught by her mama that you're going to leave her.
Mm.
And so when you leave her, that's what happened. I mean, most black women don't look at the movies. In the movies, they have the blonde-haired woman and the dark-haired woman. The dark-haired woman is always strong. The dark-haired woman can make it on her own. But then that blonde lady is weak, and the blonde lady needs somebody. Sisters, remember, let your man know you need them. I'll never forget, I came home from university once, and I said, damn, you know, marry this and marry that. And my wife said, Clyde, what about me? What about you? Well, but she said, damn. Your woman should be there. See, woman's not going to always be first. You're not going to give them all your time because if a woman had her way, she'd want you to look at her 100 all day, all night, whatever.
That's right. That's
you see?
Right.
And then, but at the same time, your woman don't want you to do everything they tell you to do because you're a simp. So sometimes
right.
you got to sleep on
That's
the couch.
Right. That's right. It's a balance.
You got to sleep on the couch.
You got to sleep on the couch a few nights. Yeah, a few times. Absolutely.
That's right. And you got to argue. And you got to argue shit when you know it ain't nothing to argue about.
Right.
You can argue.
Yes, sir.
See, as you get older, you see more eye to eye. See, people don't even understand. And I'm gonna hurry up and get through with this, Doc Rev. This is it. People talk about the opening of the chakras. They don't understand that sex, when you have a good orgasm, and if your woman have a good orgasm too, her pores open up. As her pores open up and your pores open up, you exchange genetic material to your sweat. And that's why you find sometimes that people that have been married or around each other a long time, they almost look, think, and talk alike.
That's right.
Because they've been sharing material.
They've been sharing genetic material. Wow.
That's
they've
right.
evolved as a unit. That's a beautiful thing.
Because when the chakras open,
wow.
See, that's two has become one, and then you can get in the universe. And so, But a lot of brothers don't understand if you're screwing 5, 6, 20 women,
right.
And if you're a woman and you're screwing 6, 7, 8, 9 men, you're not getting nothing out of it.
Right.
You know, in fact, you're getting confusion. And you're getting confusion because you got these genes coming in and they have nowhere to settle. Nowhere to settle. And
Ooh,
so
why
you
good.
So you
this is a whole nother lesson. I'm like, this is a whole nother show. We got.
Well, anyway, I'm gonna stop.
I feel like Phil Donahue up in here right now.
I'm gonna stop.
Oh my God!
Thank you, guys.
But you have to because we gotta keep it moving. But Doc, thank you so much for this. Thank you for blessing our lives, blessing me, blessing the ministry and family. I'm speechless. You know, it doesn't takes a lot for that to happen. Pi ratio shut me down yesterday. Dr. Winters shut me down today and helped me somebody.
No, I didn't.
Queen Mother Mahat's going to be with us tomorrow. She's going to shut me down. I'm loving it. I could just literally sit back and just be in class. This is absolutely amazing. So, Doc, I already know what we're going to do next week. We're doing the origins of race.
Right.
And there's going to be there's a special report that's already ready to go and everything. So I'm looking forward to that discourse and that cipher. I guess we'll see y'all next time on the First Frequency of Oneness and Shock Metaphysics. Hotep community.
Hotep.